Good morning and welcome to worship this morning at St. Paul's Lutheran Church of Evanston. I am Pam Vovis. I am pastor to the community at St. Paul's, and it is so good to be worshiping together this morning. This is the fourth Sunday after Pentecost, and our reading this morning is another one from Genesis, and this one is a little more troubling. It is the story of Abraham coming within moments of sacrificing his son Isaac. And so we will lean into the discomfort and ponder how God's mercy and love are given to us today in these unusual texts. And so we begin with the greeting and welcome. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation. Amen. Let us pray. O God, you would direct our lives by your grace, and your words of justice and mercy reshape the world. Mold us into a people who welcome your word and serve one another, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the 12, "Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. Whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Blackbird singing in the dead of night, take these broken wings and learn to fly all your life. You were only waiting for this moment to arise. Blackbird singing in the dead of night, take these sunken eyes and learn to see all your life. singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly all your life. You were only waiting for this moment to arise. You were only waiting for this moment to arise. You were only waiting for this moment to arise.
A reading from Genesis. God tested Abraham. God said to him, "Abraham." And Abraham said, "Here I am." God said, "Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah, and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I shall show you." So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him, and his son Isaac. He cut the wood for the burnt offering, and set out and went to the place in the distance that God had shown him. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place far away. Then Abraham said to his young men, "Stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there. We will worship, and then we will come back to you." Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. So the two of them walked on together. Isaac said to his father Abraham, "Father." And he said, "Here I am, my son." He said, "The fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering?" Abraham said, "God himself will provide the lamb for a burnt offering, my son." So the two of them walked on together. When they came to the place that God had shown him, Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to kill his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." And Abraham said, "Here I am." The angel said, "Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in the thicket by its horns. Abraham went and took the ram and offered it as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide." As it is said to this day, "On the mount of the Lord it shall be provided." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This story in Genesis is not a beloved Bible story. In fact, I would guess that it is never in anyone's top 10 list, or even maybe top 100 favorite Bible stories. It makes us uncomfortable. Who is this God that would have Abraham sacrifice his son? Is this a test of Abraham's faith? And what kind of God would do that? And what's up with Abraham? I mean, you waited your whole long life for a child, and then you would so easily give him up? Yeah, this story is problematic, to say the least. But instead of writing off this story and moving on, I think we need to stay in the discomfort. We need to ponder where the discomfort is for us. The strange thing is, this text is paired with a gospel lesson about welcome and the rewards of being righteous and giving a cup of cold water to someone in need. The emotions in that lesson are easier to lean into. So today, we are going to ask some different questions. Where do we hear God's promise in Genesis? And where do we hear words of challenge from Jesus? As Lutherans, we are used to hearing that pairing of law and gospel. And so today I want us to think about those two gifts as challenge and promise. The gospel lesson speaks of welcome and hospitality, not as the one who welcomes, but the one who receives the welcome. And to be welcome means that you have to first go out. And many times when we go out, we risk. And I'm not talking about that physical risk right now of having to leave your house during a pandemic. I mean the emotional and maybe even spiritual risk when we leave our comfort zone, our emotional and spiritual comfort zones. Just last week, 11 St. Paul's people came together to talk about race and racism, and they risked not being welcome because what if people thought they were too opinionated? What if others thought they were not woke enough and realized that they had so much more to learn? Or what if the baggage from their family of origin surfaced in the conversation? The reality was, people were welcomed. People were able to share and talk as they were comfortable. And they were welcomed and received a prophet's reward, not because they were right, but because they were open to being wrong and to learning. A prophet's reward is when everything points to God. The risk and challenge of welcome became the joy of relationship. So now let's get to Abraham. What was he thinking? He waited so long for a child, and now he will just give him up? No questions asked? God says, bind him, lay him on the wood. He just goes along with it? Twice in this story, we hear Isaac as Abraham's son, his only son. By this time, Ishmael is gone. And so Isaac is the heir, the only heir. So what happened to as many descendants as the stars in the sky? How will that happen if Isaac dies? And so a little background, because at this time, Israel was surrounded by nations and tribes whose gods demanded the sacrifice of children. Sacrificing one's child was a way to make the gods happy and to protect the rest of the family. And at the time, leaders and heads of households had many wives, and so had many, many children. It seemed like a good trade-off. And I know that sounds crass, but remember that children did not have their own intrinsic value then. It was really more about when they grew up, they would be the ones who would care for the family. And so one less caretaker wasn't really a problem. So when we hear that Isaac is Abraham's son, his only son, his loss would have many implications, not just for future generations of the people of God, but for the future of Abraham and Sarah. So what is going on here? Why is this story in the Bible? Theologians have looked at this story from many angles. God's demand for faithfulness, Abraham's unwavering faith, Isaac's unwavering faith, the reward from God for following his wishes, and more. And I would say that none of those things is the whole truth. One truth we know of God from Scripture is that God is complicated, even in God's steadfast love for God's creation. God isn't some one-dimensional figurehead that is sitting up on a throne in the sky. Remember last week we heard that God knows every hair on your head. And God is complicated. Imagine hearing this story for the first time. You would be holding your breath over what happens next. Would you be angry or resentful of God for being so cruel to test Abraham in this way? Are you yelling at Abraham, "Don't do it!" You are sitting on the edge of your chair, waiting. And then there is a ram in a bush. All that tension and anger and shock deflates by the sound of this animal. And the angel tells Abraham, "Go get that ram that the Lord has provided." A ram in a bush. I have a pastor friend who cannot hear this story without thinking about a parishioner a long time ago. That this woman was famous for saying, "A ram in a bush, a ram in a bush," when the church would come face to face with this unsolvable problem, whatever it was. She would say, "A ram in a bush, God will provide." Now, to be honest, sometimes an answer would come and sometimes not. Sometimes we hold our breath and there is not a life-giving answer just within our reach. Life can be complicated and hard and frustrating, and there may not be an easy answer, but that does not mean that God does not provide. Our ram in a bush may be the difficult conversations about race and racism, so that we can be more fully present to our siblings of color and the reality of their lives. Our ram in a bush may be the means to work from home amid the chaos or loneliness and still be able to support our families. Our ram in a bush may be the takeaway meal and cup of cold water that we are still able to provide our neighbors in Evanston who need it. And our ram in a bush may be the way we engage in our civic life to make sure that every voice is heard and every person is treated with dignity. Sometimes there are no easy explanations for God's behavior in the Bible, but that doesn't mean that God's mercy is not accessible. Our prelude today was the hymn, "There is a wideness in God's mercy." The mercy is wide, the distance is not. God is not far off. God came to us in Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. And then Jesus closed the final gap of death through his own death and resurrection. We receive the gifts of challenge and promise so that we always know that nothing separates us from the welcome of God. Amen. called into unity with one another and the whole creation, let us pray for our shared world. God of creation, we marvel in awe of the expansiveness of all you have made. Your diversity is boundless. We are grateful for Lake Michigan and the Des Plaines River, for the beauty in the Merrick Rose Garden in Evanston, for home and community gardens that begin to yield crops, and for the pollinators who further the beauty of your creation. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of counsel, all authority belongs to you. Encourage the leaders of this and every land to seek peace, equality, and unity. Install wisdom and perseverance in advocates who work toward justice in often ignored communities of color, communities struggling with poverty, and the nations of our own native peoples. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of care, you created us in your image. Help us see your likeness in one another. Open our eyes to see and attend to all who face oppression and suffering. Open our hearts to the despair and bondage our siblings of color have inherited and still feel today. Open our ears to the stories that make us uncomfortable. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of compassion, you comfort those who grieve with the promise of the resurrection. Console, heal, and nourish all in need, especially those we name now. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Receive these prayers, O God, and those too deep for words, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. This is the time in our service where we would receive the offerings that go to the mission and ministry of St. Paul's Lutheran Church and beyond. And so I just want to take a moment to thank you for the offerings that you are sending in by mail and giving online through Simply Giving. And for those of you that are giving through our homepage, with the donate button on our homepage, thank you for your partnership and your place in the ministry and mission of St. Paul's Lutheran Church. Thank you. The peace of Christ be with you all. We pray in thanksgiving to all the ways God comes to us. Let us pray. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, you have brought us this far along the way. In times of bitterness, you did not abandon us, but guided us into the path of love and light. In every age, you sent prophets to make known your loving will for all humanity. The cry of the poor has become your cry. Our hunger and thirst for justice is your desire. In the fullness of time, you sent your chosen servant to preach good news to the afflicted, to break bread with the outcast and despised, and to ransom those in bondage to prejudice and sin. Together as one body, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. A few announcements before we finish our service. Watch your email that our newsletter will be coming out in this next week. So there's lots of good things to read in there and find out what's going on. And there's even some opportunities for you to take part in things. Some you can leave your home and some you don't need to leave your home. So check that out. Thank you all for also taking part in the survey that I sent out about the interest in having a small outside prayer service during the week. We have interest, and so we will be having it. We are still making some arrangements with the worship and arts team and planning it, but it will be coming soon in July, and we will have details on that. Just know that it will be a time to reflect, a time to be with each other, and to pray and to hear God's word in a way that will be different than screen to screen. And so we are looking for that way to gather together. And as a reminder, that we will still be doing our Sunday services this way. So if you're not able to come to the outdoor services, you're not missing out on the Sunday worship. And then a few thank yous for our worship leaders before we finish. I want to thank Dr. Kurt Westerberg for our music and the creativity that he has put into the music at this time and helping it really complement and be a part of the message. For Brigitte Bell, for reading, for Liana and Dimitri German, and their beautiful music. And then finally, you will see Michelle Humphrey. We thank her for her worship leadership. And now our sending. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ. God the Creator, Jesus the Savior, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter, bless you and keep you in eternal love. Amen.
That precious word which brought me